God's children, because to this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Touch Sunday worship service. We're delighted to be able to bring these worship services to you to glorify God. Did you welcome the day by expecting to receive from God? Well, if you didn't come here expecting to receive from God, you won't get anything from Him. So raise that expectation level high. Now, as we begin our worship today, take a second to assemble a small piece of bread or cracker, a small swallow of some sort of beverage or juice, could even be water. You can use fruit, cheese, whatever, just besides bread or cracker. Set that aside, though, and later on we're going to pray over it, sanctifying it as the body and the blood of Christ. By the way, those elements are called elements of the covenant. So when I call for the elements of the covenant, you'll know what I'm talking about. Let's begin by inviting the Holy Spirit to join us in our worship service today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence in the name of Jesus Christ, our Son, and your Son and our Savior. We enter your courts with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, and they're open wide, expecting to receive your word and revelation knowledge. Our love and devotion for you flows freely from our lips, Lord, and from our hearts. We love you and magnify you. We adore you and praise your precious holy name. Lord, we thank and praise you that we believers dwell in the secret place of the Most High. We thank you that you've already heard our prayers. We rejoice because your word tells us that all of your answers for the believers' prayers are yes and amen. We thank you for the gifts of utterance, the rhema word of God, and revelation knowledge. And we thank you that the healing power of God is present to heal all who come to you in faith and in need. We give you thanks and praise for your only begotten Son and his finished work on the cross on our behalf. And we thank you that we are totally healed, made whole, and completely restored. And we give you all the honor, glory, and praise. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Now, if you don't know these songs, then just listen to the words. Let them minister to you as we worship and sing. But let's get started today.
Glory. one more month and she's got money. Works three jobs, she's barely getting by. Bob got a word, his mom's been told it's cancer. So many questions, and all of them ask why. We're living in a broken world. A broken world won't give you any answers. Everything is upside down. Wrong is right and right is wrong. But not for long. No, not for long. This broken world is cradled by a Savior. Nothing here can take him by surprise. Someday all this hurting will be over, and every tear's been wiped away and dry. But for now, we're living in a broken world. But not for long. No, not for long. Spends her waking hours praying. Her child's done gone, left everything behind. Daddy's getting tired, his faith is fading. You can't get water from a well that's running dry. We're living in a broken world.
Thank you.
In pastures so green, you lead me beside waters so calm, and you are restoring me. You lead me in paths of your righteousness, all for the sake of your name. And if I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not be afraid. No, I will not be afraid. Before my enemies, you anoint me with oil. My cup is overflowing. And each day your goodness and mercy will be following hard after me. And I will dwell
you're doing, pull up a chair, and get ready to receive. You see, we've entered God's presence with praise and thanksgiving, and now as we dwell in God's presence, just embrace the sweetness of the Holy Spirit. Bask in His presence and open your hearts to receive Him.
Thank you.
my friends, the power for God's miracles always follows the Word of God. You know, that's exactly where we're going next, deep into the Word of God. Father, let your words be my words and my words be yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Remember that because we are entering into the throne room presence of God, we must be prepared to be in that presence. So in order to go deeper into the Spirit and worship, the door that opens that depth to us is soaking in worship, which is what we just did, so that you know what that is. You know, I'm going to talk to you today about individual peculiarities. In our previous lessons, we've defined the anointing. We're in the anointing. That's what we're talking about. We've defined it, and we have talked about the manifestation of the anointing. Now, we can define and understand the anointing by watching its manifested work on the lives of those it comes upon. Bezalel and Oholiab received special skill in metalworks, jewelry, and embroidery in Exodus 31, verses 1 through 6. So in the last session, we touched on yielding to the outflow in order to receive an inflow of the anointing, if you recall. And when the anointing comes, there's an inflow and there's an outflow. And that is what causes the manifestation. You cannot say that you have the anointing when there is no outflow or visible sign or some experiences. God is an experience. Now, I know that we walk by faith and in the Word of God and not by sight or feeling. Yet we do... we just don't ignore the fact that there are spiritual experiences in the spirit realm. Now, I've said that the amount of inflow will be proportional to the outflow of the anointing of God. When we release the anointing of God, then more of the anointing of God will flow into our life. So let's look at the life of David and how the anointing came upon his life and what was manifested in his life because of it. Turn with me to the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 23, verse 1. Now, in these are the last words of David, and thus says the man raised up on high, the anointed of God of Israel, the Spirit of the Lord spoke by me, and his word was on my tongue. The God of Israel said, the rock of Israel spoke to me. He who rules over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God. And he shall be like the light of the morning when the sun rises, a morning without clouds, like the tender grass springing out of the earth by clear shining after rain. Okay, David was a man of war, folks, and however, we see in this that his life was marked with a tremendous outflow of worship and psalms. Remember, we said that there's an outflow. So unless we release the outflow, there's no further inflow of the anointing into our life. Whenever the anointing comes upon David's life, he'd always sing or speak forth God's praises in songs and psalms. He expressed himself in worship to God. So there is an outflow from his life. There could be many types of outflows in different lives, or even in the same life. There could be many types of outflow, but some outflows would feature more prominently than others. In David's life, the outflow of the Psalms and worship stands out strongly. He's known as a sweet psalmist of Israel. In other people's lives, the outflow may be strongly manifested in other types of areas. In some people's lives, the outflow is shaking. They may not be that good in singing and worshiping, but that's not their field. When the anointing comes into their life, they get into a shaking kind of rhythm. Now, I'm not saying that the Holy Spirit causes all types of manifestations. There could be demonic imitation, or it could be just simply the flesh. However, that doesn't rule out the fact that there are genuine ones. The problem is not whether there is a manifestation or not. It is a matter of discerning the type and origin of the manifestations. A manifestation of shaking comes on some people. For some people, the anointing's manifested through prophesying. Some people would just rock to and fro when the anointing of God comes on their life. Don't make whatever manifestation into a doctrine. I'll say it again. Do not make whatever manifestation you have into a doctrine. The Spirit of God once started moving on a group of people in Africa, and whenever the anointing hit the people, they would dance. Then after some time, they came out with a doctrine that unless you dance, you don't have the Holy Ghost. Well, that's not what it should be. People began to box in the Holy Spirit. You know, I mean, in other words, box him in, not box, not fight. But it doesn't mean that when you dance, that's the only evidence of the Lord working in your life. And neither does it mean that the Spirit necessarily inspires dancing. Could be in the flesh, too. What we're saying is that there is an effect caused by the anointing of God. And you won't be able to resist it. Therefore, don't take it too far and make statements like, if you don't rock, you don't have the Holy Spirit. If you don't shake, you don't have the Holy Spirit. If you don't prophesy, you don't have the Holy Spirit. That's judging people's experience by our own. And that is the unfair thing to do. There are many types of manifestations of the anointing, and we haven't exhausted every type of manifestation. Sometimes the manifestation will come in a really plain and quiet action. One thing we can note, the way you receive the anointing will be spectacular. Well, not spectacular, but it will. Well, it might be too. But I know that it will be peculiar to you in your situation. There may be similarities with others, but the way the anointing comes on your life will be special and peculiar to you. Some people get warm when the anointing comes on their life. Some people feel their legs moving. Some people chill and, you know, their teeth chatter. Some people stand up a bit. Some people believe that when the anointing's there, your hair stands up. You know, whatever. Maybe their scalp tingles. Remember, we are dealing with what we call side effects of the manifestations. So therefore, don't take the side effects and build some theology on them, because you shouldn't do that. What we need to do is to touch on the subject so that we can have some understanding of the various forms of the manifestation of the anointing, so that you don't build a doctrine. Now, during George Fox's time, the phenomenon of shaking among his people was called the Quaker movement. There are similar manifestations today. When the Spirit of God gets on the people, they begin to shake. Scorners and mockers attended these meetings and derided the anointing of God. Now, when those same phenomena came on these hecklers, they would feel their heads and bodies about to shake and vibrate, and they would resist it. They resisted the force that was shaking them. George Fox's journal contains a record of a man who resisted the shaking so hard that he broke his neck. I mean, that sounds far-fetched, I know, but it's true. I read it myself. These are what I would call side effects, okay? And some people won't make much of the side effects, but since we're dealing with this subject matter thoroughly, we'll touch on all these areas. Now, the point that I'm driving at is this. We have to learn to recognize how the anointing manifests in our own life. We can thank God for how he manifests in others' lives too, but we have to learn to recognize how he does it in our own life. If he manifests in your life through a warm sensation, then that's peculiar to you. If he manifests through shaking, that is another individual peculiarity. I spoke with one prophetess from India who loves to wear white, and she's very sharp in her word of knowledge and word of wisdom. And some people accept her ministry, but some didn't. The problem was her side effect. When she ministers, both her hands would shake, and some people thought that she'd gone into a trance, and some people thought it was a demon. I picked it up in the spirit and found that it was a genuine gift of God working in her. She's very accurate and very sharp in the operation of the gifts that she has, and she brought many people to the Lord. She passed all the tests on the word. She passed all the tests on the fruit, and the only thing that was strange to her was her peculiar manifestation of her anointing. So there is such a thing as peculiar anointing, and some types of manifestation of anointing are very dignified as well. Some may not look so dignified. One man that I know from Nigeria jumps up and down and shrugs his shoulders like a monkey bobbing up and down, and it's funny looking, but he can't help it. He lets the inflow and the outflow go as it will so that he can receive all that God has for him through the anointing. Now, there is another sub-law that I want to bring into this. Our experience of the Lord can change as we grow in the Lord. So you have to add into that factor as well. Once we learn to recognize his manifestation and how it comes, be aware of this sub-point. As we grow in him and walk with him through the years, his manifestation in our life can and probably will more than likely change. In other words, he may not exactly manifest the anointing like he did 2 or 3 years ago to you. You'll know the change as it comes. Usually the change comes at each phase when you go up from glory to glory. Now we're going to look at phases in ministry in this study, and God divides our life into phases. And usually when we move from one phase to the next phase, the sensations change. You experience changes in the anointing upon your life when you enter a new phase in your life and ministry. You know, you'll know it's a different phase, folks, and a different anointing of God that you're moving in. And we keep growing from glory to glory, phase to phase, in a different anointing of God. You mustn't forget this sub-clause. Otherwise, you may keep looking for the old manifestation and familiar anointing when God's bringing you to a new phase and a new work in your life. So why is it that way? Well, there's so many varied manifestations of the anointing. You know, what we do is we get comfortable in the one that we're in. We recognize it, and we're familiar with it, and it's like an old friend, so that we expect to have that anointing and that manifestation of it. But what may happen is this. You may find that you start with that, and then you slide right on into something bigger and different. Each of them will have a different effect on your life. So let's go back to the main point. We have to recognize the anointing coming into our life, and you have to know when it comes. Recognize the sensation, recognize the tangibility and how it comes to your life. And I want you to know something. Even if you're not in the fivefold ministry, we're all given that measure of anointing, remember? So you will feel it. You will see it. You will feel the presence of God. It may start to manifest in a feeling that you get, that God is in your presence. You may see the glory cloud. It could be anything. God's not against us analyzing this, by the way. He's only against our unbelief. If you're seeking to analyze for the sake of flowing better in God, then God's not against it. He's not against that at all. God's against unbelief. You have to have an open mind to learn from the Holy Spirit, because remember, the things that come from God are not what we normally analyze in our minds. It's not logical, in other words. Therefore, we need to recognize how this anointing comes into our life. And if every time the anointing comes upon you and your hands feel like shaking, you know that the anointing's there for you. Let me repeat this so that people don't take this kind of teaching wrongly. This type of teaching is easy to take out of context and build something funny out of. For example, someone may have a particular sensation of shaking when the anointing comes, and he goes around then saying that you must have felt that shaking when the anointing comes upon you. Don't take your individual peculiarity and make it universal for everybody else. In other words, you cannot tell people that if they don't shake, they don't have the anointing. It would be just like the guy who received the baptism in the Holy Spirit and he was in the bathtub. And one day he met another guy who said, I want the Holy Spirit. And I've been seeking the Holy Spirit for years. And he says, no problem. Come to my house. Now go to my bathtub. I received it there. So can you. An anointed bathtub ministry has started. And there's no doctrine to back it up. That's how this kind of teaching can easily be misunderstood. So understand that extreme teachings can arise, they will arise, and if you understand the peculiarities and the specific tangibility of the anointing in your own life, and you know that it's God and not the flesh, then don't try to do it when you're still in the flesh and no anointing has descended upon you yet. I used to go to a prayer meeting on every Friday night and in this one church I was attending, and we would pray in the spirit. That's what we did. And when the anointing would strike different people, they would do different things. And one lady I noticed, she'd be standing with her hands raised and she was perfectly calm, standing perfectly still like a stone. And then suddenly she'd just start to vibrate all over and her hands would kind of get palsied looking. And then when she was finished with her praying and the Holy Spirit would lift, that anointing was gone. She went right back to being that stone, that statue. So when you know that it's God, then you release yourself into them, these feelings that you have, these peculiarities. It becomes your way of knowing when the anointing has come. Flow in that anointing. God wants to take you into it because he wants to show you things and take you where you haven't been. You see, we have to recognize how the anointing comes on our life. And the interesting thing about teaching on the anointing is that the anointing is on one side and moving in faith is on the other. We have to learn to move in both avenues. Sometimes it looks like moving in faith and moving in the anointing is diametrically opposed. But they're not. They are complementary to one another. If you preach the word and tell the people not to go by their feeling but by the word of God, you are ministering by faith. If you are ministering under the anointing, you can't do that. You have to sense, not with your five senses, not with your feelings, but not with your mind, but with your spirit. You have to move into the realm of the spiritual sensory perception where you would know when the anointing, that particular and peculiar part, particular to you, is coming on. So let me give you some of my personal experiences. You may not copy it, but it's good to see how it's happening to another person's life. In the early stages of my ministry, I know the anointing only through a warm sensation in my heart. I felt like Luke 24 when Jesus was walking with the two disciples on the way to Emmaus. After Jesus disappeared and when they realized it was Jesus, they said to one another, did not our hearts warm when he spoke? I felt that sensation. That was my first recognition in my life. That still occurs from time to time. Another different sensation is now added to that warmth in my heart. I want to show the progressive increase of anointing here. Every time when the anointing's there, I feel this warm glow coming. Whenever I'm doing the right things and the anointing of God is flowing, I can feel his warm glow all over on the inside. Of course, when you have a sensation, please check it out first. Don't take this teaching to confirm that every sensation you get's from God. For example, you could be sitting in a room praying, seeking God, and you feel warm all over your shoulders. First, check whether the radiator is behind you. You know, you want to make sure that the heater didn't come on. Check in the natural. Don't reach a point where anything different is attributed to the anointing. You know, I was remember this brother who was sharing about how he was in this house and they were praying for this lady who was sick. As they were praying and everyone had their eyes closed, his eyes were partially opened. And this lady had a cat. While they were praying, the cat just came from one side of the room and jumped on top of this lady and jumped off. The moment the cat jumped down off the lady said, "I accept it. It's the anointing." And she got up and was healed. To this day, he dare not tell her that it was the cat in case she loses the healing. It would take the rug right out from under. Some people need some help like that, but check first whether it's from something from natural causes. If suddenly you feel a strange feeling on your left shoulder, check whether your shirt or blouse is too tight. Don't just jump to conclusions. Sometimes it's not the anointing. There's a natural cause, but we think it's the anointing. Check all the possible natural explanations first before arriving to a conclusion. However, there is this warm glow, which I know it is not a naturally caused. And I first began to experience it when I spent a lot of time praising God. Then the tangibility of it is there. Some people are very frustrated because they could have started their Christian life with hardly any sensation like me. I don't know why everybody else seems to have sensations of the anointing. They come to the Lord and they can cry, weep, and be touched by the Lord. However, when you come before the Lord, you don't feel anything. You wonder what's wrong with you. Now, we know the reason for the problem now. I didn't know the reason earlier in my ministry. Your batteries are flat. They need recharging. It's just like a tape recorder that runs on 6 volts, and if your batteries are about 3, then you won't have any sound coming out of the tape recorder except maybe bleh, you know. But you have to add additional batteries or juice into your batteries. Then you have the sound back. Therefore, what happens is people's word and faith level are not at the point where they can begin to experience spiritually the things of God. Now, if that's your situation, be encouraged. You have many others for company. And just be faithful to fellowship and with the Holy Spirit and get more word into you. Be faithful to spend more time in praise and worship. Just be faithful to spend more time in prayer. And when you spend a lot of time before the face of God, you will build your spiritual voltage to the level where you can sense the tangibility of the anointing. Now, I'm going to touch a point to cover those who do not seem to feel any manifestation of the anointing. When you've reached a stage where have a tangibility, that's where we have to recognize that it is tangible. And it's the manifestation, pinpoint it and understand what it is telling you. After that, the anointing began to operate just a little bit differently, where I not only sense warmth over my chest area, I sensed a warmth all over my shoulders. What happened? It increased. Together with that, I got a few other peculiar signs for different types of sicknesses, disease, and problems. I learned to recognize the peculiarity of these manifestations, and I moved into that for some time. Now, later on, the Lord changed it again, and now I feel warmth from the top of my head to the tip of my toes. And it feels like I told you before, like a cup of liquid, hot liquid, whatever, running through my bloodstream. For Kenneth E. Hagin, the anointing is like a coat thrown over him. Each person has a peculiar way of experiencing it. However, peculiar and particular, you must learn to recognize the anointing of God in your life. Well, how does it come and what does it do? That's the first area. Recognize your individual peculiarity of your anointing. You see in the book of 2 Kings chapter 3, Elisha was asked to prophesy because the three kings had problems. And Elisha said in verse 13, "Then Elisha said to the king of Israel, what have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother." But the king of Israel said to him, "No, for the Lord has called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab." And Elisha said, "As the Lord of hosts lives before whom I stand, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not look at you nor see you, but bring me a musician." Then it happened when the musician played that the hand of the Lord came upon him and he said, "Thus saith the Lord." So you see, he recognized the anointing coming on him. Before that, he recognized that it wasn't there. And I can observe that Elisha knew what the anointing was like in his own life. He knew when it came, and he knew that it was brought to him through music. He knew it when it wasn't there. He must have some way of knowing. Therefore, he has reached that first point where he learned to recognize the peculiarity of his own anointing. That takes experimentation, my friends. These things that we teach you have got to be put into practice the next time that you move into the anointing. Sometimes when you start and you're not sure, but you examine it after everything is over to see how the anointing was, then you'll see it. You'll see whether there was really an anointing. Check the result. You see, the anointing produces results. Remember, inflow, outflow. The anointing of the Holy Spirit produces power and conviction. Therefore, there will be a demonstration of the Spirit. There will be a demonstration that it was the anointing. As in Isaiah 10, verse 27, the anointing breaks the yoke. You can see the results of the anointing. This is something you cannot miss. Sometimes as you move in it, you may not be so much aware of it. Later, when you hear the testimonies coming back, you begin to realize what it was. Then you begin to check yourself, how it felt, what it was like, how did it come. It takes a lot of experimentations. Once you get comfortable with it, don't be afraid of it. These things that we learn, you need to keep practicing them until it becomes a part of you. After several times, you learn to recognize it. Learn to recognize its peculiar sensations in your life. Then flow with it. Elisha had first learned to recognize his individual peculiarity of his anointing. He also learned how to get the anointing when it wasn't there. He learned how to stir up what was called to be upon his life and what was rightfully his to function in. He learned to stir it up. He purposely asked for a musician. Now, while the musician played, it must have helped him to get into a certain stage where he could move into the anointing of God. I know a gentleman who has to go sit in a garden spot of some kind. He has to seek out some place that's beautiful to look at and lovely and quiet and peaceful where he can begin to pray and get into the Spirit. It's everybody has a peculiar thing. You know, so David was a psalmist, and the anointing upon, we're not talking about the anointing within here. Okay, the anointing upon comes and goes as the Spirit wills. The anointing upon does not remain permanently on our life, and when the work is over that it's come to perform, the anointing is lifted off. You know, there are times when there's a demand made on the anointing, and when it's not there, we need to learn to stir it forth. Elisha learned it. Suppose David wanted to draw on a greater measure of the anointing. Now, I know the first thing that he would do, he would take his harp and play it until the anointing comes upon him. Music plays a big role in the anointing upon. If you watch Catherine Kuhlman's videotapes, you'll find that music played a big role in her moving into the anointing upon her life. That's why in a worship service, we wait on the Lord through worship and praise, because he inhabits the praises of his people. Kenneth E. Hagin has also mentioned that. You know, you could be ministering under the anointing upon, but if suddenly the musicians play the wrong music, the Holy Spirit's grieved and the anointing's lifted up. There's an anointing upon that we learn to recognize. David learned to get it by music, and notice he says in one of his psalms that the songs of deliverance encompass him. Now, folks, receiving Jesus as Lord and Savior is the key to perfect divine health and wholeness, the key to redemption from all sin, past, present, and future. So right now, if you desire to come into and dwell in the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, if you desire to be in Christ and avail yourself of his marvelous wisdom, you have to give your life to him. It's very simple, pain-free, and in just a moment, I'll give you that opportunity.
Love called my name. Love. I don't have to worry where I'd be, 'cause love came for me. Love rescued me.
Beloved, to come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, repent in your heart from all sin and repeat this prayer. Lord Jesus, I come to you as a sinner and surrender my life to you. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you died for me and set me free for all eternity from all my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead and sit at the right hand of God the Father. Take over my life and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I renounce the devil and all sin. And Lord, I receive from you the gift of righteousness, total forgiveness of all my sins, past, present, and future, divine health, wholeness, and restoration, your protection, your direction, your provision, and your peace, and the gift of everlasting life. I'm yours. Come into my heart and take over my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me, then welcome to the family of God. Rejoice.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. Promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of table of the King. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King. Is every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drank death's cup that all may enter in.
One of the wonderful things that we receive from taking Holy Communion is healing of our bodies and our minds. The issue with those who take Holy Communion and don't receive their healing is rooted in lack of knowledge. Now, we have to prepare before taking Holy Communion, and the first thing that we absolutely must do is discern the body of Christ. What does that mean, and how do we do it? It means that by acknowledging that the bread or whatever you're using as the body of Christ is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus, his supernatural healing and wholeness, that because of his body and blood, you supernaturally have become bone of Jesus's bone and flesh of Jesus's flesh, that you are now filled with his perfection and power, completely healed, completely made whole, completely restored to divine health. You could think of it as a pill. It's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God. It's healing you as it travels through your mouth and down into your body. And while it's doing that, it's pushing out all darkness, which is sickness and disease, from the inside out. Now visualize the condition you're plagued with, the sickness or disease being on Jesus' body. Then put whatever the ailments are on him. Use your imagination. Now you're not giving him something he doesn't want. Remember, he already took it at the cross. So you see, the enemy's trying to trick you. He's trying to trick you into taking it. How? By deceiving you into thinking that you've got it through lying symptoms. But since Jesus took it already at the cross, you are already healed and made whole. So put that lying symptom right back on Jesus in the same place on him that you've been afflicted. In other words, see yourself with the solution. See yourself without the problem, my friends. This is called spiritual visualization. If you have to close your eyes and envision yourself different than you see when you look at yourself in the mirror because it's something that's visual, then do it. Shut your eyes and see yourself without the problem. It's vital that you understand this and do it. The next thing that we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin. Think about this. The forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future. As the restoration of the blessing of your life, you know, into your life, the power and authority of God, in other words, in your life. It's called the blessing. It was given to you at creation, and now you see this in full operation in your life. Discern it as receiving God's provision and protection, as receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ, totally carried in Christ, totally protected, thanking God for his plan of redemption. That you've been given eternal life, life everlasting, and now you no longer live under the law, but you live under his grace. Now lift up the elements of the covenant before the Lord as I pray. Father, we praise you and worship you with these elements of the covenant. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We thank you now as this bread becomes our portion of his healing body, the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed and made whole, completely restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we are continually washed in the waterfall of his blood and renewed within as we continually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. The Lord's Supper is a personal fellowship, my friends. It's a partnership with Christ. And partaking of one bread creates a partnership between all the members as well. What it does is merge us all together into one body, the church. Now, the Word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. To perform this action, continually take the bread, give thanks, and break it and eat it. Then take the cup, give thanks, and drink it, all in the remembrance of Jesus. Now, the Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often, yet Paul doesn't give us instruction as to how frequently the Lord's Supper is to be celebrated. But he does imply that it's to be done with frequency, so that partaking of the Lord's Supper continually recalls to our mind our redemption by Christ from all sickness and all disease and all sin. So do it as often as you want to and need to. As we're instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you, so that every cell, tissue, organ, and bone, all systems, neurological, blood vascular, lymphatic, muscular, skeletal, etc., are totally aligned with God's word and his will, that you are and remain healed, made whole, and completely and totally restored to divine health and wholeness. In the name of Jesus, our healer, the Christ. Amen. Partake of the body of our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The blood of our Lord Jesus shed for you in celebration of the finished work of Jesus on the cross, for the remission of all of your sins, past, present, and future. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Savior, the Christ. Amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior." The Lord's Supper is a feast, my friends. It's a feast of living union of believers with the Savior, whereby we spiritually and by faith receive Christ with all of his benefits and are nourished with the vibrancy of his life into eternal life. And for that, Lord Jesus, we are eternally grateful. You know, we always want to give you the opportunity to give to the Lord. And so today, for those who have tithes and offerings that you're sending to the Lord, remember that God is able to make all grace, every favor and earthly blessing abound to you in abundance. Lift up your tithes and offerings before the Lord and declare with me, "Lord, I thank you that you are my source, that you give me every good thing, and you give it to me in abundance. I lack for nothing, and I never run out, because I walk in the blessing. I expect the fruit of the blessing to manifest the glory of God in my life. Because of my covenant with you, I decree today that I expect a hundredfold return on my offering. And on my tithe, I expect you to open up the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing that I cannot contain. That's what your word says. And I believe it, and I receive it right now. Lord, I prosper, even as my soul prospers, and my cup runneth over. In the name of Jesus, whom I know is my supplier, I pray. Amen." Now, one more thing. When we receive Jesus as Lord and Savior, the Bible tells us that we're made a new creation or new creature in Christ Jesus. Now, the emphasis is on the in Christ Jesus. And when we accept Jesus as our Savior, we move into Christ. He surrounds us completely. With that in mind, get this picture. We are in him and he is in us. Put him on like a suit of clothes, your hands into his like gloves, your arms into his arms like sleeves of a coat, your body into his body, your legs into his like trousers, and your feet into his feet. Wherever you go, he goes. Wherever he goes, you go. As a result of this union, all of the vibrancy of his life, all of his divine health and wholeness, all of his perfection are yours. He's in you and you're in him. And like a caterpillar who moves into a chrysalis and a great exchange happens, supernaturally he comes forth as a butterfly, never to be a caterpillar again. For the rest of his life, he'll remain a butterfly. We too make a great exchange. When we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, we move into Christ. We are a new creation, but we remain in Christ for all eternity. All the gifts and promises of God in the New Testament speak about us as being in Christ, so we must be in Christ to qualify to receive those gifts and promises. We also have been given the mind of Christ. Your head goes into Christ's head. You are the head. You remain the head because the tail is no longer in the equation. You see, we're completely carried in Christ. Therefore, nothing evil can ever touch us. We can't be sick. Oh, sickness and disease can be offered to us. The enemy can try to get us to take it. How? By coming into agreement with it. But since Jesus went to the cross and triumphed over Satan, the devil no longer has any influence over you. The only thing he can do since then is distract you, move your focus off the things of God onto the cares of this world, and he's a master at it. And he can deceive you. He is the father of all lies and very cunning in his deceptions. Now, here's the reality of it, though. Satan will always attack you where you lack knowledge of God's word. So, if you lack knowledge of what God says about your healing, then Satan's going to attack you in your health. If you lack knowledge in Christian finance, Satan will attack you in your finances. His game plan is always the same, distraction and deception. So he can't give you anything. He has no power over you. Listen closely to this. The only thing he can do is offer it to you. That's right. He can only offer it to you. You make the choice in your response. And what do I mean by that? Well, do you accept the evil reports, receive the sickness and disease or lack by agreeing with the enemy? Or do you acknowledge the facts, knowing that facts are in the natural and temporary, therefore subject to change, and so agree only with what God's word and promises say about you? I know. You're saying to yourself, yeah, but I'm sick and I'm in pain. Well, that may be the case, but those are just lying symptoms, my friends. You see, the enemy always works from the outside in. God always works from the inside out, and where God is, the enemy cannot be. We aren't denying the symptoms. We're denying their right to be there. Now that we are in Christ, we are totally protected because we are in Christ. And then 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 tells us that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Well, how is Jesus? He's perfect, full of divine health and wholeness, full of the vibrancy of life, able to do miracles, full of confidence in God and his word and in himself and what he's able to accomplish for God. Beloved, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Hallelujah, that belongs to you. Every morning, the first thing, begin your day by thanking God for the finished work of Jesus on the cross and thank him that you're in Christ. Throughout the day, as you think of it, give God glory for all he's already done for you, and again, thank him that you're in Christ. At night, before you retire, give God thanks again for all he is and has done for you as your Savior. Thank him for the power of God that's in your body, coming against all attacks of the devil and keeping you healed and whole and well. And thank him again that you dwell in the secret place of the Most High, in Christ Jesus. Now, raise your hands for the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. May you open up your mouth and continually declare who you are in Christ Jesus, thanking God for all that you have received, and give honor, glory, and praise to the Lord Most High. May you glorify God with all of your thoughts, words, and deeds as the Lord continually blesses you with divine health and wholeness and makes your way prosperous as you walk in his love. Go in peace and in God's blessing. God bless you.